Well, today's passage this morning is from Isaiah chapter 52, verses 7 through 10. This is a grand vision of peace and salvation for all. And so now I invite you to hear these words of our Savior. How beautiful upon the mountain are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your sentinels lift up their voices. Together they sing for joy, for in plain sight they see the return of the Lord to Zion. Break forth together into singing, you ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. For the Lord has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our Lord. This is the word of God for all the people of God. As a young boy, growing up in the sand hills of North Carolina, living just outside of Fayetteville, where the land is very flat. If you grew up outside of Fayetteville and you grow in your Fort Bragg, I often would hear the bombs dropping. It was not unusual to hear sounds of booms everywhere I went and seeing soldiers everywhere I go. But the land was flat. And my grandparents, who we would visit probably three or four times a year, they lived in the mountains of North Carolina, in a small town called Rutherfordton. They lived on top of a big hill, probably the highest point of the town. Three or four times a year, we would make the journey to go visit with them. It would be about 5 hours, and as a little kid, these Appalachian mountains, I didn't know any difference. They might as well have been the Himalayas. And so as we approached the mountains, we were always so eager to see the site of that very first mountain. The first mountain we would always see was King Mountain. And so my mom would catch a glimpse of it, and she turned to the back seat and say, Russ, the mountains are here. And even as a little kid, I was just connected spiritually to these mountains. My face was glued to the window, and I would ooh and ah over each one, the size and the shape. And I would say, whoa, look at that one. Look how big that one is. There was a kind of spiritual connection to them. Today's passage begins with all of these people who have been exiled out of Jerusalem. All of these people in this vision are looking up to a mountain, staring, watching, hoping. They were living a decades-long tragedy, having been exiled from their homeland, exiled from their culture, exiled from their relatives, many of whom are grieving the loss of their loved ones, many of whom are exiled from their own beliefs, having to assimilate to a new culture and a new belief system. All they had was this faint hope that God would one day have them return and bring peace back to their land. And so we have this grand vision from Isaiah. It's a vision of people on a grand battlefield, but it's not a battlefield of two armies. It's actually bigger than that. It's a battlefield, the battlefield of history. And on this field, there are casualties, there are tragedies. And we who are a part of this battlefield of history, we have suffered our own tragedy, suffered our own setbacks, our own challenges. We have grieved people. And if that's who you are, then here is the message for you today from the book of Isaiah. Keep an eye on the mountain. Keep an eye on the mountain, because one day the great messenger will bring forth news of victory. Today's vision doesn't begin with today. It begins way in the future. And the messenger, who is God, comes from the mountain and brings good news to everyone, to all nations, not this one or that one, but to all nations. And so he says, keep your eye on the mountain. Stay focused on the one who will bring the good news. In the Bible, the mountain is where we meet God. In the Bible, the mountain is where God is. Jesus did a lot of things at the beach. But the mountain is where we meet God. When Noah crash lands his ark from the flood as the waters recede, and God makes a covenant with him there, he does so on top of a mountain. When God meets Moses to tell him to free his people, he does so on a mountain. When God meets Moses again and gives him the Ten Commandments, he does so on a mountain. When God met Elijah and he heard a still small voice, he met him on a mountain. When Jesus gave us the Beatitudes, he did so from the top of a mount. When Jesus retreated to speak to God, he did so to the mountains. God met Jesus on a mountain and he was transfigured. And when God ascended into heaven, he did so from the top of a mountain. The mountain is where God calls us to. The mountain is where we meet him. This past week, I was reminded of a famous line from President George W. Bush, State of the Union address. He was speaking early in his presidency about why we should go into the second Iraqi war. And regardless of how you feel about that war, he dropped a little bit of wisdom that night that I think still rings true today. He said, in trying to defend the war efforts and saying how evil Saddam Hussein was, he pointed to all of the atrocities and he said to everyone there in Congress, he said, if this isn't evil, then evil has no meaning. I think there's great wisdom in pointing out an evil and saying, this is evil. This right here, this is evil. Because if we don't point that out, then we tend to whitewash all of the terrible things that happens and we can't differentiate. And so maybe last week on Sunday, as you turned on the news, you watched with horror the footage of what happened to that church in Texas. If that's not evil, then evil has no meaning. That was evil in its absolute purest form. And so maybe as you thought about this week, maybe as you came to church this morning, you thought a little bit extra about coming. Maybe you had to muster up a little bit of extra courage before you could come to church today. I even wondered out loud this week. I thought to myself, I wonder if church attendance across the country will be impacted by what happened. Possibly. Bishop Hope Morgan Ward, our bishop, reminded us this week of what was said to her this week by an African bishop who, in light of this week's events, said to our bishop, you know, in my country, in Africa, it always takes courage to go to worship. In fact, it takes courage for Christians everywhere to go to worship. It always has. Because, he said, all Christians are targets. This is not new space for us. In fact, first century Christians, they had to worship in homes because they were afraid of being persecuted. Christianity has its roots. Its roots took hold in the soil of persecution. But it also dared Christians to live their life with faith and conviction and with courage. Good can come from tragedy. In fact, tragedy can sharpen our faith. Tragedy can train our eyes to stay on the mountain. And after each tragedy that we see, or after each tragedy that we ourselves endure, we always ask ourselves two questions. The first question is this: what does this mean? What does this awful thing that took place in the world, or this awful thing that happened to me, what does this mean for me in my life? And why did it happen? Well, that's a hard question to answer. In fact, many of us, there are things that happen to us and we never can figure out why it happened and what it means. There are things that have happened to me and I will never know what it means until I get to heaven. And that's just the nature of things. We have to learn to live with the mystery of why certain things happen. But the second question is one I can talk to you about this morning. The second question is, how do I live? How do I live? In the wake of last week's tragedy, there's been this ongoing debate about mental health and guns in our country. That's an important debate. But as Christians, we see an even bigger picture. Matt Sulcato reminded us this week, he reminded all Christians that our battle has never been against just flesh and blood, but our battle is against evil. And how does one fight evil? But with courage, conviction, and faith. By doing so, we keep our eyes upon the mountain. You see, evil wants to create so much fog that you lose sight of the mountain itself. And so the way that we fight evil is that we keep our eyes upon the mountain. When I don't know what to do, when I'm burned out, when I feel the strains of life's pressures, when my heart is hurting, when I don't know what to do, I turn my eyes to the top of the mountain and I move toward God, because that's sometimes the only thing I know to do, is to keep my eyes on the mountain. Maybe you heard on Monday, the minister and his wife of that church, they weren't actually at the church when the shooting happened. They were away that Sunday. But their 14-year-old daughter was there, and she perished in the trash can. Now, they were being interviewed the next day. The minister's wife, who was so raw and just so honest, said, "You know what? Half of our church is gone now. They're in heaven. I don't know what's going to happen to our church. And our building, it's so, well, they're probably just going to tear it down," she said. And then they asked the minister, they asked him, what's next for your church? Which is another way of asking, how do I live? I loved his response. Maybe you heard it too. He said, "We're going to do what we do. We're going to pray, and we're going to ask God for help." In other words, what he said is, we Christians are going to do what we Christians do. We're going to keep our eyes on the mountain. We're going to keep pushing forward. Even through the fog of tragedy and sadness, we will live with faith and courage and conviction. We don't know what's next in the short term, but we're going to keep our eyes on the mountain no matter what happens. In the 1980s, there was a young medical researcher who was hired by the world's second biggest pharmaceutical firm. And it was his job to produce great research that would produce medicine, that would produce money for the pharmaceutical firm. But this man had a very deep-seated conviction. It was a conviction that was supposed to be shared by the firm, but wasn't always. And the conviction was this: health comes before wealth. Health comes before wealth. So in the 1980s, this pharmaceutical firm developed a medicine for cats and dogs that would cure ringworms. And this became the second biggest money-producing thing for the pharmaceutical company. It was a huge hit, and it was curing dogs and cats across the country and all over the world. But then someone in the research department figured out that it might be possible to adjust this medicine for humans to cure another disease called river blindness. River blindness was essentially suffered by people in very poor third world countries. It was transmitted by insects, and it was a disease that millions and millions were being impacted by. So there came a moment of truth. A moment of truth. Are we going to invest millions upon millions of dollars into this research to try to help people in a third world country? Or are we just going to, you know, play it safe and focus on other sure money-making ventures? Well, the head of research, who had that deep-seated conviction, said, "I want to do something important with my life. And I know I'm going to catch a lot of flack for this. But let's develop this research." And they did, and years later, it turned out that they did discover the cure for river blindness. But then, there was another dilemma. How much are we going to charge for it? This is an expensive piece of medicine, and the only people who can afford it are the people who don't have the money to buy it. How are we going to get it to them? They live in the most remote places of the world. This is an impossible and an improbable way to make money. What are we going to do? Another moment of truth. But again, he said to himself, health comes before wealth. And so he pushed them against all the criticism to give this medicine away for free. And in doing so, the U.S. government helped get that medicine out to the people who most needed it. In case you're wondering, it costs this pharmaceutical company $20 million a year to produce it. That's how much they lost. In total, they spent away $200 million total before they eradicated it. But in the end, 18 million lives were impacted by this medicine. 18 million. Economists all over the world, this became a famous story, and economists all over the world criticized this man, saying he was supposed to take care of his stockholders. Those were the ones he should have been most loyal to make money for them. But he said, no, my conviction, what I believe in, is that health comes before wealth. That was the mountain he had his sights set on. That was his guiding light, his guiding principle. And look what he did. I mentioned to you before visiting my grandparents. They lived in a tiny town of Rutherfordton, North Carolina. They probably lived at the highest point of the town. Their little neighborhood street was on this giant hill. It might as well have been Mount Everest to me. But to them, it was this giant hill. And every morning, my grandfather went through the same routine. He would get up every morning, walk about 2 or 3 miles early in the morning, wave to everyone on the street, in the car. He did this every single morning, a man of routine. Well, 20 years ago, we lost my grandfather very suddenly. And let me tell you what happened. He woke up one morning to go through his routine. It was a crisp, cool fall morning. This neighborhood street is so beautiful in the fall. The leaves, when they would fall, it would just create this giant road for cars to come through, and leaves on either side. And that was his path that morning. And he got up, as he did every day, walking down the hill, walking through town, waving to everybody. And then when he got to that last leg, he had to go back up the hill to his home. Now, he had this routine because this was such an empowering kind of walk for him. It was very spiritual. He wanted to finish it strong, and so he would often really speed walk up the hill, sometimes even jogging up the hill. My grandmother would always get on him and say, "Roy, do not jog up the hill. You are too old to be jogging up mountains." But that didn't stop him. And on that morning, he got to that hill, and he was feeling good. Feeling empowered by the beauty in God's nature, by the beauty of this fall mountain scene. And he began pushing himself up that hill, walking fast and then jogging. Then his heart gave out. He collapsed and he passed away within seconds. A neighbor who witnessed this happening said he was really pushing himself up that hill. My grandmother even said later, "I am so mad at him. I told him not to do that, and he did it anyway." Could my grandfather have survived another day if he hadn't pushed himself up that hill? Sure. But if I've got to go and leave this earth, I want to do so jogging up a mountain and not crawling away from one. Beautiful is the mountain that has the feet of our Savior. Will you pray with me? Lord, like those who are in exile, like those of us who are in the midst of great tragedy and challenges, help us now to keep our eyes upon the mountain, looking straight ahead at what is most important in this life. With faith and courage and conviction, God, help us to move and push toward that mountain. Lord, give us faith now to see what you have in store for us. In your name we pray. Amen.